I'm excited to have Greg here today because part of, you know, part of the challenge of putting those teams together is to be able to find mentors. How do you find the right people that can give you advice and input? How do you find the right story to tell? How do you put the right pieces together that you have a great story that people would be willing to invest funding or money in part of your program so that you can carry the ride to make it successful? And with that, of course, comes a lot of expectations, a lot of pressure that you don't want to lose money. You want to be able to turn it into a winning scenario. And so Greg has had a whole series of success in being able to do that. And so we are really thrilled to have him here today. So Greg, if you're ready, come on down and we'll turn the mic over to you and we'll get out of your way and just totally hear the words of advice you have for us. Greg Warnick, people.
Yeah, can I keep that mic nearby? I might use that one too. Say that again?
You need some for the audience?
No, I'll just need one.
Okay.
You ever see a sunrise or a landscape and the thing that comes to your mind is that you want to share it with other people? You ever hear a song or watch a movie and your first thought is, I wish so-and-so was here with me? Maybe that's the thought that's behind Instagram and Snapchat, Facebook, because there's a human desire to share something that you see that's beautiful or interesting or enriching in some way. And that's how I feel about entrepreneurship. So I will talk about mentoring. Before I do, I just want to talk a little bit about entrepreneurship in general. I feel it's incumbent upon me because of the life I've had in entrepreneurship to fire you up about it. And so I'm going to spend part of my time just doing that. My father grew up in Richfield, Utah, 3 hours south of here, actually in a little town nearby Richfield called Sigurd, which probably you've never heard of, but it was a farming town. And my dad and all of his relatives made up about half the population of that town. They lived on a farm. He was the youngest of 10. And grew up milking cows and chasing chickens and doing farm things and really hating every minute of it. His growing up years, as he talked about them, his primary goal was not to raise his sons on a farm. He hated snakes. He hated milking. He hated everything about it. Just wasn't his thing. And being the youngest, he watched his brothers and sisters grow up. Some were able to move away from the area and build a life elsewhere, and some didn't. But when it became his turn, he was really focused on that. He became the star center of the Richfield High School basketball team. He was a very good student at Richfield High School. He came up here and spent some time at BYU and some time at the University of Utah, and he got accepted to Harvard. He graduated in accounting, and he was accepted to the MBA program at Harvard. And then, as it is now, he probably felt like, that's my life-changing ticket. And I was born in Boston, second child to my father, when he was going to school at Harvard. When he graduated from Harvard, he packed up the Pontiac Grand Prix, drove across country interviewing with corporations that were looking for MBA graduates. He drove south along the eastern seaboard, two or three interviews there, crossed the south through Texas, came back up to Utah to visit family. My mom and myself and my older son were still back in Boston waiting for the outcome of all these job interviews. He stopped here, and my wife's parents lived at the top of the hill in Orem, just behind the school here. So he stopped in to visit them and talk a little bit about how he was discouraged about the interviews he'd had so far, didn't feel like anything was a perfect fit. Continued from here, after a brief stop with family, out to California, interviewed with Hewlett-Packard, and that's where he felt like he found his home. He called mom up and said, you know, it's kind of early spring, maybe still a little bit wintry, and out in California, he said, there's flowers everywhere, and blue sky, and no traffic, and this would have been maybe 1962, and he joined Hewlett-Packard. So let's think about the frame of mind that he had. That was at a time I don't know, have any of you seen the movie Hidden Figures? It's out right now. It's a pretty good movie. It reminds me of other movies from that time period, like Apollo 13. Bunch of guys in white shirts, little skinny black ties, very few women on the job. And they really felt like they probably would spend the rest of their lives, or at least decades, in that role and in that job. And that's the way my dad was at Hewlett-Packard. They moved him around a little bit, repositioned him, but for 15 years, he worked at Hewlett-Packard. And until the entrepreneurial bug sort of bit him, there was sort of the expectation that there's a bond between your employer and the employee back in the 60s and 70s that was going to last a long time. And all of his work, getting off the farm, being a good student, going to Harvard, was to try to get that moment where that first job interview coming out of school would go well, and he would get on the right company and the right team and stay there essentially for his career. So how's that different than it is today? Just think about that for a minute. You guys are students here. You'll graduate. Thinking about your careers, how many of you think that you'll come out and get a job and be there 15 years? Right? It's almost unheard of. You're not going to strive for tenure or for a gold watch or for a pension. You probably don't trust any of that. Where will you find security? My dad found security in a degree from Harvard and a job at Hewlett-Packard. Where will you find security? How will you be able to look at your spouse and your kids and your family and feel like I'm doing the things necessary to provide for them and offer them a stable environment and have a successful family life? What comes to mind? Where are you getting that security? Where will you get that sense of safety in today's world? Anybody have an idea? I would say that in today's world, when the average tenure on a job is less than 5 years, it's probably just from yourself and your abilities. Think about what a job means today. It means that you need to spend some time satisfying a boss and impressing them with your accomplishments, convincing them that you need a raise and that you need a promotion or you deserve one. How are those thoughts different from entrepreneurship? So let me just sell entrepreneurship for a minute. Let's take it at a global perspective just for a second. Does America have the richest natural resources in the world of any country? So why is America so successful over a couple of hundred years relative to the rest of the world? We don't have the natural endowments, resources, or advantages of really anything. Climate, natural resources, we don't have the natural endowments that would lead you to say, well, this makes perfect sense to me why America is so successful. So what is it? It's the innovation and entrepreneurship of a young country, right? It's nothing, it can't be anything else. So bring it down to the community level. What are the benefits of entrepreneurship to a community? Think about a university campus like this, or like BYU or the U, and think about the names on the buildings. Entrepreneurs tend to give back to their communities, and that enriches our lives. The theaters that we attend, the ski resorts, the sporting events, a lot of that is sort of driven by entrepreneurship in one way or another. If you think about it, you can trace it back, and you don't have to think that hard to figure that out. I like to race cars. Would Utah have a racetrack if it wasn't for Larry Miller? Zero chance of that. Would tax money build a racetrack? Get that through the legislature, good luck with that, right? So a lot of the things that enrich our lives, that give us opportunity, that teach us, that empower us, come from entrepreneurship. Down to the family level, we're driven by a need for self-reliance and independence. And where can that come from? Right? We come from a pioneer heritage here in Utah. We're used to doing things on our own. We're used to bravely moving forward, sorting things out on our own, solving problems, creating, innovating, working together. That's all sort of entrepreneurship. And what about the individual? I mentioned that we're wired with a desire to share, a need for self-expression, a need for creativity. How does a job satisfy any of that? It doesn't, on any level, or rarely so. But entrepreneurship, on almost every level. Entrepreneurship is a form of self-expression Your business that you create, the business ideas and products, are an extension of you and your personality. Your team, your work environment, your culture is all reflective of the things that you believe deeply in. So entrepreneurship at a global level solves problems, creates products, creates wealth, innovates, makes our lives better, our health better, and you just stack it all the way down to the individual, and it pays off on every level. Entrepreneurship is not a respecter of your personal attributes. Entrepreneurship doesn't judge you. Entrepreneurship only enables you. If you have disadvantages, think about our history as a country. Would you agree with me that if you are in a minority group, a woman, in some way disadvantaged in another way for a couple hundred years, you probably have the deck stacked against you slightly or less than slightly? Entrepreneurship doesn't care. Entrepreneurship doesn't care about your advantages, your disadvantages, your family situation, your gender, your beliefs. You're only satisfying customers, and they're mercenaries. They're easy to predict and satisfy, right? You're only satisfying customers. You're not defending yourself or your abilities or attributes to any other human, just to a customer. That's why entrepreneurship is so powerful and magical. The more you understand it and what it can do for you and what's easy about it and what's hard about it, it can have a dramatic impact on your life. So you're here today, and that tells me a couple things about you. That you have an interest and a curiosity about entrepreneurship. You may be enrolled in the program, major or minor. You may think, I'm in chemistry and one day I might want to use that chemistry in an entrepreneurial way to create a business. That's perfect. You're in the right room. You're having the right thoughts. And the more deeply you think about it, the more you'll realize you don't really have any other great choice in today's world. Entrepreneurship is what wins today. So let's talk a little bit about what it is and what it is not. Have I sold you on it pretty well? I hope. Let me take the three of you to do a little experiment. Here's a quarter. Let's imagine a game that we're going to play with these quarters. It's a coin toss game. And the rules are, if you flip it and it's tails, you owe me a dollar. And if it's heads, I owe you $5. That's the game. So you tell me what your strategy will be if those are the only rules. The answer that I hear sometimes, what would you do?
I would go for it because my bet's lower.
Go for it. You'd flip the hell out of it. As fast as you can, as many times as you can, if those are the only rules. Right? You're in college. You flip the hell out of it. You understand that that's the only rule, right? So just think for a minute now. In what way is entrepreneurship like that? Is entrepreneurship, can you think of it as a game of probability? Does your mind get there a little bit? How many times can you start a business in your lifetime? Everyone put your hand up. And when I call a number that you believe that's the number that you can do in your lifetime, take your hand down. Every hand up. Can you only do one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11. This is an entrepreneurship class. 15, 20, 25. I think it's about 7. I've funded 150 entrepreneurs. I've watched 500. I think by the time you start a business, especially if you think about it kind of sequentially, and there's an argument not to do so, you think about your career being sort of 25 to 55, you can have about 7 at-bats. In what I've seen. Some entrepreneurs can do much more. There was a time when I was running 7 companies at once, small businesses. I was 28. And so depending on your mentality, depending on how you perceive opportunity, depending on how you structure your pursuit of it, you can do much more. But let's just say 7. So Do all entrepreneurial opportunities have the same distribution of outcomes? You know what a probability curve is? A bell curve? Imagine a bell curve around zero. If it's symmetrical and it's around zero, it means the outcomes below zero are equally probable as the outcomes above zero. So there is a business out there that you could start that would have that attribute, that the probability that you would lose a dollar is the same as the probability that you would win a dollar. Do you believe that the probability of outcomes of every entrepreneurial business are exactly the same? That your chances of winning and losing are the same? Start moving your heads a little bit and communicating with me. Yes or no? No. Starting a lawn care business or a daycare business or a nail business or a software company or Domo or Vivint are different. The outcomes are different. What you can lose and what you can gain are different. So your job is to perceive those differences and choose the ones you'll pursue that are worthwhile. But it's like this. Do you believe there's a business that has a 5 times greater chance that you'd win a dollar than you'd lose a dollar? Does that business exist? Can you imagine it? Take lawn care. What are the chances that in 1 year you'd lose $1,000 in a lawn care business? Could it happen? Yeah. You could wreck your truck and dump your lawnmowers all over the freeway, and it's possible that you'd lose $1,000. What's the chance that you'd gain $5,000 in a year? It feels like it's almost, it would be hard not to. So if that's the situation, what's your strategy? Do as much entrepreneurship as you can reasonably pursue. So start thinking about entrepreneurship a little bit differently. What's the scarce resource? I can't tell you the number of times that people say to me, I would be an entrepreneur, but I don't have a good idea. What do you think the chances are that that actually represents somebody's circumstance? Almost never, in my experience. What is a good idea? Is it cold fusion? Or is it something that you've seen someplace else? You saw a business when you were traveling in Canada. It doesn't exist here in Utah, so you started up. It's a restaurant concept. It's a software concept. It's a services business. It's a disaster recovery business, whatever it is. Do you have to invent it such that it's never existed on planet Earth before you do it? No, so divorce yourself from that idea. Divorce yourself from the idea that I have to think a thought that's never been thought by mankind before, and then I have to write a business plan, and then I have to go raise venture capital, and then I have to go IPO. Divorce yourself from all of that. That's not entrepreneurship. That's 6,000 businesses out of 2 or 3 million that are started every year. So take the 3,000 Harvard venture businesses, 6,000, put those aside and think about big E entrepreneurship. And what's the rest of that? You ever study the Inc. 500 list? That's really an interesting read for me. The last time I took a deep dive in it was a few years back. But the analysis uncovered that the average revenue of those businesses was just over $10 million. And they were not generally venture-backed. And the startup capital required to launch them was $42,000, last time I looked. They're not going IPO, but they're fantastic entrepreneurial successes for their owners. So lock your sights on that. Lock your sights on what is the scarce resource. It's time. You need to go as quickly as you can. Ideas are not scarce. In today's world, money is not scarce. My firm has $250 million to invest in businesses, and we're looking every day, all day, for businesses to invest in. And there are thousands of firms like us. Money is not rare for good ideas. Ideas are not rare for thoughtful entrepreneurs. The only thing that's rare is your time. That's the only thing that's scarce in your entrepreneurship. I'm inching closer to mentoring because that's how you increase your batting average, is through mentoring. The only thing you're missing from your entrepreneurial journey is judgment. You have access to money. You have access to ideas. The only thing that you're short on is the judgment that's born of experience. And that you can borrow. You can borrow it from your personal network. So that's a roundabout way. I'm telling you these things because entrepreneurship has been so good to me and my family and so good to people around me that have been successful at entrepreneurship. Even those who have tried and failed have been happier in their journey than those who have been in jobs. Generally speaking, managers and businesses have lower job satisfaction than entrepreneurs who are currently failing at their effort. It's so empowering, it's so energizing, it's so full of variety and learning that it's more fun even when you're not winning. It's more rewarding, you're learning more. So I'm sort of making a case for why I would come back to you and share these thoughts, because we don't have a relationship that would cause me to do anything other than for you than to share with you something that I believe is important, impactful, and true. And that is, from where you sit today, entrepreneurship may be the most interesting path forward as you think about it. And I sort of come around to part of that is because the way the world is wired today, we talked about that, you can't derive your security, financial or otherwise, from a job, from a pension, from your Social Security, from those things that my dad leaned on. They're not there in the same form that they were before. So you have to figure something else out. And entrepreneurship has become wildly more interesting, not less. The amount of capital in pursuit of good businesses, looking for uncorrelated returns to the stock market, is many-fold higher than it was two decades ago. So the money is there, the ideas are there. Your minds are better trained because of your exposure to innovation and new product cycles and technology. So we're going down this mental walk to entrepreneurship, defining a little bit about what it is. It's a game of probability. You will lose sometimes. Your job is to hedge against that, increase your batting average, move as quickly as you can, and the only thing you're missing, I'm just recapping, is judgment. And the way you get judgment is from the network that surrounds you. A mentor is a special case of your personal network. It's not more than that. So let's talk just briefly about your personal network, then about mentoring, do one more little exercise, and then take questions. Your engagement in your personal network perhaps will be the most important thing that you do in the next few years. And the way you engage in it, the way you approach it, the way you talk to other people, there are true principles about that activity that if you ignore them, you'll do so at your own peril. The first is that you share freely. There are people in this world who are wired to say, I have a secret, and I'm going to keep it to myself. And if anyone wants to have a conversation with me about that secret, they have to sign an NDA. People put NDAs in front of me every month. That is a silly way to conduct yourself in this world. Ideas get better by you sharing them with other smart people and allowing them to criticize your idea and help you work it through to improve it. If you keep it to yourself, it stays the same, except gets stale because it's less applicable in the future than it is today. So share freely. Share what you know. Secondly, be accurate in the things that you say in the network. Imagine yourself just pulling up, you know, to a room like this. Let's say you're my personal network. Anything I share with you must be true. Don't speculate. People will act on things you say. They'll make decisions based on things you say. If I come to you and I say, I have a great painter, and you need a painter, let me introduce you to him, and that turns out to be a terrible painter, then what happens to him in my network? It's just a simple example of what happens in your personal network if you share information that's not accurate. People stop trusting you. They stop asking you. You don't get invited into the conversation. And all of that happens when you're not in the room. He tells her, well, he introduced me to a painter, and the guy tracked paint all over my carpet. I'm not even in the room to defend myself. So your network changes, and you pay a price, and you're not even there. There's another piece that's sort of about humility. If you meet somebody in a social setting and we have a conversation and I just talk all about myself, I show no genuine interest or curiosity in you. I tell you all about me. And then half an hour later, you walk away. What's in his head? What's in his head is, I don't want to talk to that guy again. That's the last thing I'd want to spend my time on. So if you show genuine curiosity about the lives of others and their interests, and a humility to the way you approach the network, then you'll be much more successful. So there's a few principles that you could think about. You're at that age now when you're starting to develop your network, and I'm just trying to stress to you how important it is. And mentorship is just a subcase of your network. So the same things that you think about mentorship, you would think about your network. People want to know what you're up to. They're curious. They want to know about your entrepreneurship. They want you to share it with them concisely, accurately, and with humility. And sometimes that's the entree. If you can't tell somebody in 20 or 30 seconds what you're working on, and I'm going to say this kind of softly, what you need, they don't really know how to engage with you. I've never met any of you here in the first three rows. I have no idea what you're working on, but you could be working on a business. You could have an idea. I might be able to help. But unless you tell me what that is or I have a way to know it, I can't help you. So nothing's coming back your way until you're able to articulate your kind of elevator pitch. It doesn't need to be about a business or product. It can simply be, I'm an entrepreneur. I'm looking for people that can give me, you know, insight about business operations, about international expansion, about some specific industry. Just kind of for you and what you're up to. It's personal, it's accurate, it's humble. But you should have a way to park yourself in the heads of other people so that they know who you are and what you're working on. And you should be able to do it relatively quickly. So let me just make sure I'm on time. I got another 5 minutes? Okay. Can I have you're filming. Can I have the first seven of you in this row come down to the stage for a minute? I'll be nice to you, don't worry. Come on down, this will be fun. And just line up right here. I brought you gifts to compensate for your personal risk. Some of the companies that I've worked with in the past are Stance and Skull Stance. Anybody a snowboarder? Snowboarding socks from Baldface? Socks? Harried, 3 p.m. player. Sweet. Headphones. You can have the backpack from Cotopaxi.
Oh, thank you.
And the socks. All right. Let's role play for a minute. You're you. You're the student. I'm not asking you to do anything that you're not doing, and I'm me. I'm a 57-year-old funder of businesses, manager of Mercado. I have money, I have ideas, I have a rich network built over 30 years. You're young, in school, maybe approaching the end of school. Today's today, it's all very real. Let's just imagine at the end of my talk, I'm walking out that door and you're standing next to that door and it's your moment to try to bring me into your network. And so I'm gonna bring a microphone, I'm gonna say hello, and I want you to say whatever you would say today to create a connection with me that might last for a while, that we might work together, share ideas together. I might become part of your personal network. You're terrified.
Hello.
Introduce yourself to me. Hello.
Hello, I'm Devin Shepherd. And what's your name?
Greg.
Greg, nice to meet you, Greg. What is it that you do?
I'm an investor.
Investor. I'm looking to invest in my business as well. Are you looking for people to invest in?
I am.
Well, I'm interested.
Hello.
Am I meeting you for the first time or am I just now for the first time? Hi, I'm Alex.
Hi, Alex.
What was your name?
Greg.
Greg. It's nice to meet you. What do you do?
I'm an investor.
You're an investor?
Yeah.
Wow, how long have you been doing that?
30 years.
30 years. Wow. Okay. Well, I'm actually an entrepreneur myself, and I definitely, I'm looking into a certain product idea, and I don't know, you've probably had a lot of experience with that, and I'd love to learn from somebody like you and seeing if this is something that would be investors like yourself would be willing to invest in, and if it'd be, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Something like that.
Hi.
Hey, I'm Trevor Hansen.
Trevor.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you.
I came to your class and I heard that you are a very successful entrepreneur. I'd like to maybe sometime have dinner with you and talk business.
All right. Good. Hello.
Hi, my name's Aubrey. You're from the Boston area?
Aubrey, I was born there.
I actually grew up 20 minutes north in Bedford in Lexington area.
Nice.
So I'd be really interested in talking to you about investment ideas. I'm super into like the fitness industry, so it might be a little different, but interested in how you get started and stuff. So I'd love to meet sometime and talk about that.
Okay. How we doing? We're four into it. How we doing? If you were me, how would you respond to these first four? All right, let's keep going.
How's it going? Good. I'm Zach Figgins.
Zach.
I was just in your class. You know, I have a lot of good ideas that I have never been able to run by anybody else, just besides my close personal family and friends. And so, like, I'd love to sit down and have the time to be able to speak with you about some of my ideas.
Okay. Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Hi. Hi, Greg. My name's Chris.
Chris, nice to meet you.
Good. I was in the class. I enjoyed your talk that you gave regarding entrepreneurship and mentorship. There was a few questions that I had that I wasn't able to ask. Would you mind if we took a minute to talk about those?
All right. What do you think of that? Is that the best one yet? Why?
I've had the most time to think about it.
All right. Hi.
Hi, Greg. My name is Virgil Wirch. I was just in your class, and I was really interested in some of the things you said. I'm a senior here at UVU, and I would like to hit the ground running when I graduate. And if there's any time I can pick your brain, I would love to sit down and meet with you.
What do you think? Thank you, all of you, for being courageous. And I hope you enjoy that swag. You can head back, and we're just going to talk about you for a while now. Thank you.
Thanks.
So somebody who has a thought, raise your hand and tell me what would have worked, what didn't work, what was the turnoff. Just put yourself in my shoes. You're really busy. You're already working 70 hours a week. What's going to cause you to take on somebody else's project or problem or get your brain picked or go to lunch?
Well, I don't know which is correct or not, but I think it was great how she made a personal connection with you. So you'll remember her as one that was from the same area you're from.
Yeah. He said a couple interesting things, personal and memorable. What else? Give me some more ideas. Okay.
I think always being ready, knowing what you're going to say ahead of time, so when that opportunity does arise, you can just drop your elevator pitch, and that way you're not stumbling and babbling over your words, and you come over as an idiot or something.
Personable, memorable, prepared. I think that's a good point.
I feel like if I was to approach someone like yourself, it would need to be a win-win situation, a win for me as well as a win for you, or else it won't really interest you at all, since you're such a busy man, you know?
That's a great point. What would a win be for me? ROI?
Being able to help others.
It's an interesting thought, because I've done this exercise maybe two or three times, and there was one time we were passing the mic, and somebody said, I know you collect muscle cars, and I've seen your website, and they made an offer. You know, can I propose something that would integrate some of your personal hobbies into your website? It's a little bit off the mark, but what I loved about it was the idea that it was an offer. Make an offer. In your first meeting, make an offer. Don't ask for something, give something. So now you're asking yourself, what could I ever give? There's a couple keys to unlock it. One is preparation, which we talked about over here. So if you knew you were coming to hear a speaker, could you prepare? Could you read a bio? Could you hit LinkedIn? Could you know something about me in advance? Of these, however many were here, seven, half of them said, so what do you do? So that, what's the signaling when somebody says, what do you do? Signaling is, you don't really value the encounter. You're being opportunistic. You haven't planned it. What if somebody said, I've been to your website. I noticed you invested in Skullcandy. I took a look at the packaging, and I have some ideas because I'm a specialist in this or that, or I'm a web guru, or I'm from Australia, or I've whatever it is, anything, right? If you could find something to attach to by doing research, that's valuable. And if all of that fails and you can't find anything contextual, what could you do? You won't get this one, so I'll just tell you. You can go read until you find something interesting that you think is shareable and then share it. You can always find something. You're going to be networking up. You'll always be networking to people who have a little bit more experience and judgment than you that can help you understand what the bell curve is of an opportunity, how you can execute against a plan. You're always going to be networking up, and you can always find something. If you're a constant reader, you can always find a tidbit. Every once in a while, I'll get an email from somebody that will say in a paragraph, here's what I found, here's why I think it's interesting to you, and here it is attached. And go to page 3 and read the bottom half. It's a very curated share with me, and I like that. I'll almost always go open up and read it because I know they spent some time on it, and it'll create a relationship launch in a new way. You all have had relationships that have been launched on, I ask you for things and you ask me for things, and that's kind of one kind of relationship. Let's put it over here. The very first thing that happened is somebody said, I have a business and I want to pick your brain. I want from you. They asked first time. And if I do that, then maybe I've created a situation where now I have the ability to ask for something. And our relationship is ask, 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 ask. And that works. It's quid pro quo. What about when somebody gives you something first? And then you feel like, if I see the chance, I'll give back. And the relationship is give, 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 give. And it can be out of order. It's just abundant. That's a different way to think about it. So if you start your business relationships with a give, which sets up the win-win, but it's he wins first, she wins first, my networking target wins first, that's even better than trying to win simultaneously at the same time. Can you research the people you're going to approach? Yes. Can you thoughtfully prepare what you're going to say? Yes. Can you articulate something that's a give first? Yes. Can you personalize it? Yes. Can you make it memorable? Yes. Can you do it in a setting like this to somebody like me or whoever is here next week? Yes. And that'll create a situation where you can find a couple of mentors. My mentoring history is like the story of two Allens. I had a mentor in my 30s and 20s, and I've had a mentor in my 50s, and they're both named Alan. And they are both men that had something different to offer me, which was extremely valuable. And it had to do with spiritual things, life balance, giving, and not so much execution. I felt like I had execution, but I was over-focused and imbalanced in my life, and both of these men brought me a sense of balance and grounding that was extremely valuable to me. And they unleashed a potential in me that I didn't know I had. So mentoring can take various forms. Last point before questioning. What's the type of information that you seek more than any other in your pursuit of entrepreneurship? If you had a row of entrepreneurs up here who'd been very successful, and you were granted one question, and from it, you were going to get a complete, full, and perfect answer. What would your question be? They wear a lot of hats. They're business leaders. They're recruiters. They seek investment. They sell product. They're probably some form of engineer. They have some technical skill related to the product. They're marketers. They're managers. They do all these things, and they have all this knowledge in each of these areas. And now you have a magic wand. You have one question. What would you ask about? What's the knowledge that would be more valuable than any other? I want two more. How did you do it?
How did you decide?
How did you decide? How did you choose a bell curve that worked for you?
How did you use your success to
giving back. I'll tell you what I think. It relates to another question that I've received throughout my whole career, and it sounds like, what's the most important attribute for entrepreneurial success? Similar question. I receive it steadily throughout my whole life. My early answer, had to do with leadership. In my 30s, it had to do with persuasion. In my 50s, my answer is this. The most important attribute a CEO and entrepreneur can have is the ability to predict buyer behavior in the market you address. Full stop. If you had one question you could ask an entrepreneur, my suggestion to you would be, it has something to do with customer demand. Everything else these individuals are doing is execution. You can probably hire it done. The one thing that you can't outsource is judgment about buyer behavior. I have a product. If I make it bigger, will I sell more or less? If I change the price, will I sell more or less? If I paint it red, will I sell more or less? If I put it in a box or a bag or add Wi-Fi to it, what will happen? What are features worth in the mind of the buyer? And the CEO or entrepreneur has the ability to accurately predict buyer behavior in the market they want to address, has everything they need to win. Everything else is execution. If I had a fantastic leader that couldn't predict buyer behavior, what would happen? If I had a fantastic marketer that couldn't predict buyer behavior, what would happen? If I had a fantastic technologist that couldn't predict buyer behavior, quickly you see that it kind of breaks down. So what does that mean for networking and mentoring? Would you seek in a mentor, you know, a CPA or an attorney? You'd probably keep in mind, I'm looking for people who have insights about customers, above all. I'm looking for people that are a little further away from me, so their networks are rich with unknown facts to me. If they're right next to me, if I go to my uncle and say, will you be my mentor? We share 20% of our network and have similar experience. Get somebody a little further away from you who understands customers and go after it that way. I'll pause there and answer questions, but I hope this journey has said entrepreneurship is important, that you can win, that networking is a key, and that mentoring is a subset of networking that has specific attributes, and your ability to approach them and pre-think it is key to your success. Questions?
Hey, raise your hand. We'll come and raise your hand. We'll come and get a microphone to you so we can hear you. Here we go, right up here.
With how technology is available at our fingertips now, why is a degree valuable to an entrepreneur?
I'm not sure that it is. I think when you come out of school, it shapes your thinking a little bit, creates a sense of independence, builds your network among some peers. So those things are really valuable. But I think the experience born of your efforts in entrepreneurship are as important as what you might learn in class. If you can couple those through internships or your own activity after school, I think that creates the richest environment.
Through all the your support groups that you had or your mentor, what helped you gain the courage to take that first step and to give your ideas or things like that a chance? It's like starting your first business or your second or third.
I took a bit of a pattern from my dad. In his midlife, he moved from HP to being an entrepreneur. And so I had the advantage of having a pattern to follow. But if you don't have a pattern to follow entrepreneurially or somebody to encourage you, you sort of have to find it in your peers. Entrepreneurship can be a lonely journey. And if you have a few people to bounce ideas off that are around you, could be your classmates or someone in your family, it really empowers you. And I think you've stumbled on probably the largest inhibitor to entrepreneurial activity that is just starting. Having a bias to act in the way your head works is really valuable to entrepreneurship. Just try something. Let people talk you out of it.
How did you decide, or how did you find a mentor, somebody who was willing to spend that time with you to help you? that's pretty much it.
You know, I wasn't very purposeful about it, and my thinking was not as crisp now than when I was young, or was not as crisp when I was young as it is now. But as I went through life and met people, some of them just inspired me. And I felt like I wanted to be like them. I wanted to emulate them, and I spent a little bit more time with them. I tried to find ways to be helpful. In both cases, I did some consulting work for those two Allens before we became such good friends. So I did give first, but it was instinctive. But I think you, where you are in your careers, you could do sort of a scan of the network around you and of the community around you and purposefully seek out 7 to 10 individuals that you might think about. And some of them won't respond to you. It's a two-way street. You don't hit it off. But out of 10 efforts, a couple will come together, and you don't need more than a couple of entrepreneur mentors. You don't need 6 or 7. You need 1 or 2. So you could be much more purposeful than I was.
Thanks for coming. It's very good. I've got a quick question. You said to accurately predict the customers' and buyers' behavior, and then you said something about the market, and I didn't get that. Could you?
I didn't say anything in the market to qualify that statement about accurately predicting buyer behavior. That is the answer, period, full stop, in my view right now. If you can predict how demand will shift based on how you change feature and pricing, or how your mix compares against your competitor's mix and why people choose one or the other, that's all you need to win.